Now we have a journal, which is the only journal in India in corporate governance with many experts from India and abroad on the editorial board. It has also got into the dean's list of this Australia. So we have that. Also the policies, you know, which should help, you know, Bodo people to perform better, and the policies which may help government in evaluating the performance of the boards. So corporate governance index, which you're talking the other day. So that kind of work we have been doing. They have been also guiding PhDs, they've been writing status papers, and just before he came, I had a call from Minister of Corporate Affairs. He's content. What IP is, what the work you are doing in the area of corporate governance, what are your activities in the corporate governance, what is that you have published? So they have published prolifically in numerous journals abroad. There are also a part of the network on corporate governance. So ADB has a network, so they are a part. Then OECD has a network.
Yeah.
They are a part. OECD has an international network and also an Asian network. They are a part of that. Is that the government has been saying that we are privatizing. But in the days of privatization, also number of public enterprises at the federal level is increasing. At the state level, it is increasing. Not only that, as I was saying, public sector has become a funnel of transferring its money to private sector. With government of India now is facing the problem of slowdown. They don't agree to that. That they say that our rate of growth has come down, but there is no slowdown. Now what is happening is that the consumerism has come, and therefore money at the hands of consumers is not going into investment. Earlier our rate of deposits were 38 to 40%, then came down 30% of GDP, then came down 30%, 28%, 26%, now it is around 22 to 23%. Rest who lead the economic community, so you work as much as you. And Professor Bimal Arora, here, and that very distinguished academician at Ashton School of Business, connected to several organizations in UK and abroad, right from the small firm to global organizations like UN, and has been in India for some time, involved in several self activities and having huge demands on his time.
And we're lucky that he took us in his fold and gave us an opportunity to meet him at Delhi, where we had CBR conference of the Ashton School with 800 participants from India and several from other countries there, and gave us an opportunity to see how things are going all over the world in the area of responsible business, what it is, what do people think about it, where it is now, and how far it has to go, what kind of steps have to be taken. In India, sir, when you talk of time, we talk of 24 hours. We don't say day and night. And I think you are a living example of that, because I don't think after coming to India, he has even taken a wink. All the time he's traveling. And I must appreciate, sir, and thank you on the behalf of all my colleagues that in your itinerary and engagement schedule, you didn't omit IP. Because there are several organizations, and today also when he's here, UN officers, they're waiting for him at Delhi to meet, and he has asked one of his colleagues to, I think, do that, because he thought that we need his time more and that we have greater potential to develop. Well, UN is already developed, so we need to develop. I think we're really grateful to you, sir. I think Professor Lagna Sarkar will throw light. There is possibility, I think, that we are exploring, and that Professor Bimal Arora has been thinking of involving IP in the area of some areas of research, CSR, corporate governance, sustainability, management education, and plethora, I think, of other things that the time goes. So please give a big clap to sir. Professor Manfred Max Bergman, again, a guest of Professor Arora. And Professor Arora has developed, has been thinking of having a tripartite understanding between the Aston School of Business, between them and between IP, and then hammer out, I think, a sort of, you know, program which would evolve, I think, over a period of time, where, you know, we can share, we can work together, and we can move forward, understand, I think, the problems in a very deeper way. The Professor Bergman is here with us, and Professor Bergman is at University of Basel, Switzerland. And, you know, I think, you know, we always talk of Basel 1, Basel 2, Basel 3, and I think several other things. So please give a big clap to Professor Bergman. We also have Dr. Jeanette Bergman.
Again, a person who is interested, I think, in the kind of work that has just outlined the area, I think. We are very close to her heart, and we are
extremely grateful, so please give a big welcome to her. Can I request Professor Sarkar to formally introduce?
Very good morning to all of you. As IP is intending to form a tripartite, IP ICAR, which is Aston India Center for Research, and Basel Trilateral Partnership for Research on Corporate Responsibility in India, Corporate Governance, Reorienting Public Enterprises and Related Topics, I welcome Professor Bimal Arora from Aston Business School, Professor Manfred Max Bergman, University of Basel, Switzerland, and Dr. Zinit Bergman, University of Notre Dame, US, and also University of Basel. May I please request Professor Kiranmay to give a floral welcome to Professor Bimal Arora. May I request Dr. Sinju to please present a floral welcome to Dr. Bergman. May I request Dr. Lakshmi to please present a floral welcome to Dr. Zinet. I take the opportunity to formally introduce Professor Bimal Arora. Professor Bimal Arora is an assistant professor in management, CSR, sustainability at Aston Business School, holds a visiting research fellowship at Global Development Institute and at the University of Manchester, and serves as the honorary chairperson of Center for Responsible Business. Before joining the full-term lecture at ABS, he has worked on various research positions at Alliance Manchester Business School. He has been having an experience of more than 25 years in policy, practice, and research across diverse sector, and has undertaken consultancy work with governments, large and small businesses, and civil society organization. He has been the chair for the Dialogue Platform and Conference since 2014, and was the founding director and CEO of Center for Responsible Business, which was incubated by Doshe GIZ, and a Social Accountability International and Business Social Compliance Initiative Foreign Trade Association between 2010 and 2013 as a part of German Federal Ministry for Economic Cooperation and Development, supported by public private partnership. CRB has involved into Independent International Center for Excellence, facilitating social and environmental impacts and organizational behavior change towards incorporating responsible business strategies, policies, and practices. He has huge number of list of publications to his credit, with a lot of citations to which we have quoted. We have Professor Manfred Max Bergman from University of Basel, Switzerland. He has been the chair of social research and methodology at the Department of Social Sciences. He's a member of the Research Council of Swiss National Science Foundation, the Swiss UNESCO National Commission, the Uganda National Academy of Sciences, and Sustainable Development Solutions Network, a global initiative for the United Nations. He has studied at the University of California, Geneva, Cambridge. Since 2014, he chairs the Basel Sustainability Forum and the World Sustainability Forum. Previous academic affiliations include the Universities of Cambridge, Florence, European University Institute, Geneva, Loyola, Chicago, Notre Dame, Oxford University, if I'm pronouncing it right, Stellenbosch, St. Gall, Texas, and A&M, the Witwatersrand, and Zurich. The research and teaching activities of social research and methodology are mainly focused on sustainability in relations to UN Sustainability Development Goals and the UN Global Compact. He has worked with various universities of repute across the world and has been a commission member of UNESCO NATCOM since 2015, technology group of University of Basel, as well as a doctoral candidate to the University of South Africa. Apart from her mobility, she also works on education and health in Africa. We welcome you, ma'am, to IP and look forward to working with you.
She's responsible here
for our admissions division. Has taken out, this admission numbers from 240 to 1,100. So she knows, I think, she believes in Keynesian, this multiplication factor, I think, She has published widely. She is also an econometrician. And she has done a very interesting book on econometric applications for those who study economics. Another very important book she has published is on power sector development. We have here Sam there. Sam is an engineer and an M.Tech and then a Ph.D. in the field of management. Supply chain management is her area. And then we have a Professor Kalig, who is an expert in the area of industrial relations. And she's also our head warden of this institute. Then we have Professor Mishra there. Professor Mishra is a linguist. She had done her PhD on Naipaul. I was just mentioning a few minutes back to you. She has also published widely. We have Dr. Shankar. She is an expert in the area of organization behavior. She has published widely, and her PhD is in ethics. Then we have our colleague, Professor Mehrotra. Professor Mehrotra is from BHU, and her work is on corporate governance. She is currently working on whistleblowing. There is an act on whistleblowing and comparing our whistleblowing system with the whistleblowing systems abroad. She has also published politically. She also heads a two-year MBA program on insurance, banking, and finance. Here we have Dr. Sridhar Raj. He is an expert in the area of human relations. He is also associate program director on training, and recently she also looks after our advanced leadership program, where we train these leaders in management in public and private sector for 1 week here. Then we take them to Netherlands, to Rotterdam School of Business. From there, we take them to Lausanne School of Business, then to SDA Bocconi, then to HEC. So he was there, he has just come back. Professor Ramesh is our colleague who has taught abroad in Korea and other countries, and he is working on sustainability systems and new accounting, I think. He's working in that area. He's also head of our three-year MBA program, which we run for this Dismane University in that old institute. Professor Vidyarthi is a fellow in management, and he's an expert in infrastructure. He has published recently in a very important paper, which is very, very, highly cited. And Professor Raman is our associate dean with Professor Murthy there. Professor Raman is an expert in the area of digital marketing, and he's also an associate dean. He has published widely. Then here we have Professor Ashish is our expert in the area of entrepreneurship. He's from Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India, published very, very widely. Professor Shlokna Sarkar has already been introduced. Professor Geeta is our head of public policy. Professor Kiran has been introduced, and Professor Murthy is our dean. He has taught in all the three IIMs. He doesn't teach the IIMs lesser than that. Either they have to upgrade or he not teach. So he's, all IIMs request him. But his basic, this thing is that, are you of that? If you're not there, I can't come. And he is an expert in the area of finance. He had done papers on debt equity ratios and taken the theory, which got the Nobel Prize on debt equity ratio. Which was that? Morgan Miller. So his paper on refinements of that theory has been acknowledged internationally. So this is the small group. Others are busy in classes.
Okay, thank you so much, Professor Mishra. You have been too generous in your introduction. I'm actually humbled to be here with you, to be here spending a day with you all. And I didn't expect this to be such a formal way of so. So I would want to make it a little informal, I am myself an Indian, I know what it means and how we do things here, and why we do the things the way we do it. But few thoughts in terms of what Shuragna has introduced already. The purpose of my visit, my friend here, Professor Bergman and Zinet, and the idea was a few months ago we started talking about exploring a collaboration. I and Max have been working, and Zinet have been working actually for a few years now, several years actually. Research in particular, my own area of research is social responsibility, sustainability. I've been, like she said, I have been involved in setting up a specialized center based out of New Delhi, which was a German government-funded project for 3 years, and I was supposed to incubate as a specialized market-based kind of a center, which meets the needs of the market on issues around social responsibility, sustainability, which also fills in information and you know, processes around policy related, these kinds of issues. So which I'm pleased has kind of evolved. So I was the founder director until about 2014, and then I moved back to UK where I wanted to be. I've been a researcher at heart, and I've been trying to be a researcher myself for last few years, actually, you know, several years I've been doing that. So I decided to go back to academics and do things. Now, two, three things which stuck me while the organization grew, became fairly decently recognized in India, internationally, the kind of work we do. Professor Mishra was kind to be there with us for 3 days. So last week we had a whole conference, and it's a sixth edition of the conference. Like you said, you know, we have about 700-800 delegates from all over the world who come to the conference, about 70 plus partners. So it serves as a platform. So it's not a conference that we organize as an organization. It serves as a platform where we invite organizations to co-host a session on different themes and issues. So, and because the reason I thought, you know, the idea about CSR, since the law of CSR was passed, CSR has taken a particular trajectory in India. CSR has been around before that, of course, but there's a lot of interest within India, among scholars, among organizations, and I call it a new breed of, you know, consultants have come up because of this whole new CSR law. But the problem, I mean, I know Max doesn't like that by saying it, but you know, developing or drafting a law without defining a term, picking up a term from somewhere, and making a law out of it, I don't know what was the purpose behind it. Why do you make a law where do you want to, you don't want to define it, you don't want to, merely listing issues in Schedule 7 doesn't help. So there's a lot has to go into this, and that's where my own personal opinion and understanding, being a student of CSR for almost, 25 years now. I've been a student of political economy, of social responsibility, CSR. I've been examining and doing all that stuff. And when this law was passed, while on the one hand I was very happy, I worked very closely with Bhaskar Chatterjee on this issue. I was involved in the drafting of the course, the first course that they launched, 9 months course. So he asked me to write a curriculum for that, without
ICP.
Yes, exactly.
You do it here. Partner institute.
Yes. So I kind of initially I did about 50% of work. Then he was not ready to acknowledge me. So I said, I mean, I'm not asking for money. At least give me my name at least. But we know how things work here. So then I withdrew from there, and they decided to do whatever has happened, and without going into further details of it. But my own sense has been, on the one hand, I have been excited about this law because there are certain things very good about in terms of which I say that this law brings CSR to the mainstream. It helps in a country like India, the notion like CSR which globally has understood to be a voluntary notion. This law has helped it to bring it to mainstream. Otherwise, you could, before 2013-14, you could count in fingers how many companies are actually involved or doing anything about it. Now they claim there are about, within the framework of the law, there are about 16,000 plus companies which are expected to do something about it. So that's, in a way, mainstreaming. You know, some people have to think about it, and possibly we as a society are better complying than voluntarily doing things. So more possibly there are issues. So one, it has mainstreamed. Secondly, and again, my discussion, level of deeper discussion with Bhaskar and others in the ministry who have been involved in drafting this was, there was a particular thinking in terms of how to do it. And there was this whole projectivization, the whole idea of board level committees and a setting aside of money and those kinds of things. So it gives a kind of a framework. Again, possibly companies are expected to enjoy this way of doing things. Not everyone is, of course, happy, because those who have been doing more than what the law prescribes, they have started trimming down to 2%, you know, in a way. But anyway, so that's broadly my, and this is what we have been kind of jointly working on writing, and our interest, joint interest has been, which comes from what Max is going to talk about, our work has been around exploring how in India as a country, as a society and an economy, and other countries like China, for instance. These are the two countries, while there have been different BRICS and those kinds of things, but India, China in particular have a potential and some demonstrable evidence to say or claim that these two countries might be disruptors in the world going forward. And there are some reasons, very, very solid reasons for that, for us to think and believe that. He comes from a part of the world where the society, the regulatory processes have moved in a particular way. And he sees the limitations of the way of those working. I have myself been in UK for almost, 15 years now. So I know that society also to some extent, how that society works and the limitation of everything they have regulated or over-regulated or processed, over-processed. So I tell them, you're going to go down with processes, you know, maintaining 40,000 words or 40,000 pages of rankings, you know. So they have much more expertise in process developments and all that stuff without losing the whole spirit behind what happens, because then process is driving, it's not humans who are driving things. So at some level, so these are some of the things. Plus, there are other reasons. We came together, and early this year, we decided to develop a program, what we call, if you allow me to introduce that, RE21, which is Rules of Engagement for the 21st Century, how India and China are going to impact or change those rules of the game for the world. We have seen, you know, nationalism, the whole wave of nationalism in US, in some European countries. There are different kinds of factors which are coming. So our interest has been to put together a program and research program where we examine these factors more closely. How would that happen? How may that happen? Or how may that not happen? So this is an hypothesis we are in a way working on, that this might be the case. But we as a scholar have to research it. And then on that basis, we make our claims, what we're going to do that. And it so happened that, and I lead a program, IDRC, you mentioned. IDRC gave me some money last year to run a project. In Aston, we have a center called Aston India Center for Applied Research. I'm a joint director of that. So we've been trying to shape programs for India-related programs, research, faculty development programs, and then different kinds of. There's an annual conference which happens in Aston University every year in August, September. So in that process, when I came across colleagues from IP, Shulagna in particular was there, and you were there particular, and the conference, the presentations were made. My pain point has been that scholars from India, the training for there are exceptions, please don't get me wrong, anywhere, the training for research and the doctoral research that we have in this country, there are some loopholes and weaknesses. And we are not able to produce scholars who are able to compete internationally, who are not able to publish internationally. In North America, US, and another, you know, Australia, New Zealand, they have created some kind of a mechanism and system for publications and knowledge production. So the knowledge to, on the one hand, I'm critical of the way they deal with knowledge and they define knowledge. You know, if you are a A-rank journal, so you are a world-class scholar, and you are a B-rank journal, you publish in a B-rank journal, then you are a particular kind of a scholar. So that has some limitations, and there are a lot of critiques around that. But at the same time, we as scholars from India are not participating in those dialogues and debates. You know, when Professor Mishra was giving an introduction, there's a huge work, you know, let's illustrate his career and history of this institution and huge publication and everything. But if those are not known by others, if you are not engaging in, as scholars, our work speaks through our writing, speaks through our publications. What we do is, Professor Mishra is a scholar, I am a scholar, I am writing, critiquing his work or building on his work or learning from his work or his work. We are debating through publications. That's what's not happening to a greater extent. I'm saying there are of course exceptions. I know very good scholars from India who publish internationally based out of India. Now there are two things here need to distinguish here is scholars from India who go out from India. And then they publish. Then there are scholars within India who stay in India, and then those who publish internationally. So publish internationally, again, this is a medium or a means to an end, but the idea is we are debating on ideas. Research is an idea we are debating. Our idea, we have thought about it, we have researched about it, someone else has researched about it, we are engaging in dialogue. And we are cumulatively building on that knowledge base. And we are generating some knowledge which then others in policy making, in industry, in non-profits, they pick up those ideas and they work on those to some extent. And that's how it should be in terms of the way research should happen and the practice should happen. Evidence-based policy, evidence-based research. But in lack of those kinds of things, of course, practitioners have their way of doing, policymakers have their way of doing, so they do whatever they feel right. But limiting my discussion here to the scholarly work, we need to be as a scholar to be able to engage with scholars at particular level. It's not about publication. A long list of publication doesn't matter if you're not debating or engaging with scholars who matter, who are the key scholars, who key people who are producing, propagating an idea, and if you're not critiquing them or building on them or working on them and presenting our ideas, it has a limitation to some extent. So that's when we started talking, and the other project that I said, which I'm kind of principal investigator at this point of time, so what I did was I created a multidisciplinary global network of scholars. The focus of the project was in India. The geographic focus was limited to India, but we are interested in understanding how private sector can or could possibly contribute to the achievement of sustainable development goals. Sustainable development goals are now international frameworks accepted widely. Until 2030, there will be post-SDG also, I'm sure. But for now, we are looking at how private sector is able to contribute to these processes, which is about how societal issues are addressed by the private sector. You know, coming from different theories, there are limitations to how and what private sector can or should do. So that's what we are trying to do. There are arguments in this field of business and society, social responsibility, sustainability, that which are normative to some extent also, that businesses should and ought to be, they are a part of the society and they ought to contribute to the society and take society along. So when my interaction with IP colleagues happened, and what I felt was a major chunk, and again this was connected to our discussion, was we are in our work leaving out state-owned enterprises. For India, for China, these two countries, they are a very critical and major component. While, of course, there are in other countries, but in China and India particularly, they play a huge role. And we don't, I mean, our assessment is, while there is, you know, we are selling Air India, we're selling different kinds of institutions, it's not going to go out. It's going to be there and contribute, continue to contribute. So our story is not complete if we only look at private sector. And who better can for us to collaborate than IP in this case, to work with us and form a tripartite relationship. And that's when I proposed to Professor Mishra, let's explore that. And he's been very gracious, kind, and supportive of the idea. Max was also very supportive. And that's when we decided, let's talk and let's start thinking about what and how we're going to do this collaboration. So few thoughts here. Basically, we met last week during the conference. We had first round of discussions. What we agreed was, and I proposed to the you know, colleagues here, that this possibly could be another network, multidisciplinary network. Now I'm going to tell a bit in terms of how I'm trying to work this out as a network. So it's not a network out there working and all that stuff. What I'm trying to do is I'm using the project, funded project, as an opportunity to form this collaboration between scholars from the so-called West or the developed countries and India. So the idea here is two set of scholars work together, identify an area of or phenomena of interest, research on that, collect data jointly, work together, and publish together as a team. So one point here is that scholars from US, Europe, Australia, New Zealand, Japan, they work with our colleagues in India here. And we jointly do the research and we jointly publish internationally. Now, there is a skill involved here. Going international publication, it's more than knowledge and rigor. There is a skill in terms of how do you frame your argument, how do you frame your paper, how do you position your paper within that dialogues and publications. So that learning that skill is important. And that skill can possibly come when we work with them, those who have done that, been successful in, I'm going to use the term, game. It's a game. Besides knowledge production, it's also a game. So it's better to learn with those who already know how to play this game, instead of slogging ourselves out, you know, and getting. So the international journal editors who I work very closely in Aston, you know, Professor Pawan Budwar, who's a colleague of mine, who is a chief editor-in-chief of one of the high-ranking international journal, who was there with us last week. He says that, and most of the editors I speak to, the publications or submissions which come from India or developing countries are not able to match the quality or the rigor to become publishable. So by doing this kind of a network and this kind of a collaboration, my objective here is to push scholarship, research, and publication, international publication, by working together. Now, this working together, I'm going to be again coming here because some of the things I've been discussing with colleagues here from different institutions. So we have about, the last week, the meeting we did, we had about 35 scholars from different IIMs, IIT, IIFT, BIMTEC, OP Jindal, BM in Bunjal. So we had scholars from different institutions sitting in the room where I was introducing the project. What is this project? What is the network? What are we doing? How are we doing? So the second element is, because I'm doing a bit of an experimentation here. Collaboration happens in different ways. You go to conferences, you meet somewhere, collaboration happen, you know, we meet, we understand each other. But in this, what I'm saying is, I'm putting a time frame. I'm saying, I'm getting this network together, bringing you all to focus on a very specific, within a broader scope, for a specific phenomena, over a period of 16 to 18 months, please produce a submittable draft as a team. If you're not able to do it, don't commit. Because I know you all are, everyone is into so many things. So if you're not able to commit this time, let come in the second phase. Because in the first phase, because I'm trying to develop this model, I have to demonstrate and show results. So what I'm doing is, as a part of a global multidisciplinary network, we are producing projects within that. So team of 3-4 scholars coming together, agreeing on a specific phenomena of interest, and agreeing which data access I'm trying to facilitate that. I'm supporting the expenses related to data collection analysis, not covering the time of anyone. Because we are a scholar, this is our time is covered by our institutions. So any expenses involved, I'm covering the cost. But you need to commit to produce a submittable draft of a particular quality, a particular level of journal submission in 12 to 18 months. And thankfully and interestingly, I was not myself sure it's going to happen, it was going to work. 6 months ago I started, and we have 20 projects with about 80 scholars on board. Everyone has committed that. And which is interesting. So. What I would propose, Professor Mishra, here is that in this collaboration and partnership, we focus on the public enterprises, state-owned enterprises. You do a lot of work, and you know, a lot of centers, a lot of things. We can't get into everything. So if we want to make it successful, we need to focus. On a pilot level, I'm saying let's agree on a pilot level for a few years. 3 institutions we are involved. 3 institutions together jointly form this collaboration and a network. Again, this can be a global multidisciplinary network. But people interested in examining and studying public sector enterprises in India, in UK, and possibly in Switzerland. To understand the role of private sector state-owned enterprises to the society, to economy, to different kind of things. And depending on the discipline that you come from, depending on your interest, we develop those small projects, whether it's related to finance or HR or OB or economics or policy or whatever. Those can be different projects. And we can open it up for people to join. We can invite expression of interest from scholars from the West, scholars from East, to come and collaborate on specific areas of interest phenomena. For instance, in my private network, what I'm trying to do here is some of the very interesting projects are coming. For instance, one project is looking at how women workers are involved in the global value chains. So they are trying to examine that very specific phenomena. I'm not, because lack of time, I'm not going to go into the detail, but idea is how the global frameworks like United Nations Sustainable Development Goal, when they are translated to a national level and reach to the firm level, how that implementation of global frameworks at a firm level happen. So these are the kind of projects we are defining and developing. Similar could be an approach we could take here for the private public enterprises. In terms of how, going into the specific phenomena. Now, another thing which is, again, my effort or intention here is in doing this, is my personal belief, again, going aligned with what Max does and believes, We believe there is a lot that the world can learn from us. We have a lot of things going in the country, but because we are not able to publish it at appropriate forums, they're not known. They're not researched well. They're not presented well. Most of the things, a few examples I give is, you know, the whole idea of Prahlad's bottom of the pyramid notion started from India. Khanna and Palepu, who are there in the Harvard, they started the whole institutional void idea from India. They took it internationally. Now they are internationally accepted, including in India. Our own RCT, Dada, Nobel le gaye. So, it started from here. Now, so can we do this? Can we identify those phenomena? Research on it, write, take it to the appropriate forums? Last week only I did a collaboration with Tel Aviv University, a friend of mine, a collaborator of mine. We organized a two-day event on anti-trafficking and supply chains, human trafficking and supply chains. And she's again got a grant from European Research Council, 5 years grant, and she said she was looking for examples where there are worker-driven responsibility or social responsibility. She couldn't find a case. I said, we have tons of cases here. But no one knows, because we have not written about it. She found one case in Florida, which has been written in appropriate or right journals. So where do scholars pick up? International scholars, where do they pick up their work from? They pick up from international journals. They don't pick up books, or hardly, rarely pick up books, you know. And then those are peer-reviewed. They have established way of establishing knowledge. So if we as a group of scholars are able to do this, identify, and we know best what exists here. International scholars, he doesn't know what the challenges are. He would, so many things we speak when we are in a, you know, things that we talk in a room, it's a tacit understanding between us. We know that this is how things work in India. For him, it's going to be very different. He may not even make sense of what a lot of things, I'm not, with all due respect. So I'm saying a lot of people who come who are good in theorization, theorizing a phenomena, they're good at it, but they don't know the context. We know the context. Context alone is not enough for publications in international journals anymore. You cannot say that we have done this study in India and please accept it. Doesn't work like that. So there has to be a context and theorization both. How do we use India as a reference point? Case studies, issues, phenomena, micro, macro, we take out from here. We know day in and day out, but we don't think theory. We see the description. So many papers are presented in last week's conference, so many scholars from different institutions, all big names. Research for them is write research questions, go to the field, get the answers and present the research. This is what the research is. Nah, doesn't work like that. Your research question itself has to come from literature. This is basic thing. In a whole presentation, one reference. One something, and this is not just in India sitting. I was in August in Academy of Management conference, which is a biggest mela of management institutions or management discipline. I went to a session deliberately where Indian scholars were presenting to see if there has been any change. Same story. We operate at a description level. How do we change ourselves? How do we lift our work? We need to learn that. I have been here, born and brought up myself. I have been there also, so I know. And my effort here is to see if I can be, you know, some kind of a peddler, so to speak, to peddle these things and make things work and have our great scholars here do the same level of discussions and dialogues with international level, where then we are able to say, you know, that yes, a lot of things are there, we can learn, we can teach people. And we also have to learn from you know, minute things which we take for granted. Tacit things, again, I said, we take for granted, we don't get into the details. So that's, these are some of the small things I keep trying. And like I said, he has given too much of weight, what I'm trying to do. But it's an honor for me to be here. It's a great honor. I'm hoping we are able to develop this. These are few ideas that I'm not going to further detail. We'll talk separately. But basic idea is in this trilateral collaboration, as a collaborating, three collaborating institutions, we form a global network. And then we invite expression of with a focused phenomena or interest scope. And we invite expression of interest from scholars from here, from out of beyond, and we kind of work together to generate that momentum and energy on PSUs, on SOEs, and how they are different. Now, they are very different, distinct entity. You know, last year I held a program here in this conference. So I do this every November. Basically, so what I do is there is 3 days of policy conference where we have all these people, then there are 2 days of academic event. So last year it was about business groups as a phenomena or as a separate or distinct entity. India has a huge amount of business groups. So how globally or internationally business groups are seen and analyzed and studied as a distinct entity and a phenomena. Similarly, public sector enterprises are a distinct entity. They have their characteristics and their ways of operating, and we need to theorize from that. Taking them as a distinct entity, an organizational entity and a phenomena with its own complications. And then we look at and examine different side of it. My personal suggestion would be that we focus to, in the first instance, on some specific issues to keep the scope limited so that we are able to produce results over a period of 1, 2, 3 years, whatever we agree. And if it all goes well, then possibly we can go beyond, because a lot of work that you do, we can't do everything. And if we go open, then we are going to be confused a lot ourselves. Thank you so much for listening to me, for giving me this opportunity to come here. And I'm really honored. I'm looking forward to working with all of you. Thank you.
I must say that it's always so motivating to hear you. And we all are very hard workers. I'm sure all my colleagues would agree to me